No. Hello and welcome back to another episode of Unsung. Thanks for listening. You can catch us on the web, SoundCloud, Unsung Everyday People, wherever you want to look online. I think this guest is my shortest from stranger to show guest I've ever had. Usually I know the people, and it's interesting. The reason I asked him is because he's interesting. I met him as he was dropping his wife off in the insane asylum. car slowed down when we got off. It looked like he was pulling away. I was like, what the heck? we struck up a conversation, and I found out, like everybody, and I think everybody has a story, and everybody, well, most people are more interesting than they come across, and they have something they do. And I was pleasantly surprised to find out the order in which, you know, he mentioned the things that are his passions. And one of the things he talked about was the Mitzvah Foundation, and I actually know somebody who benefit from them. And in the middle of just very tumultuous time, that was the only organization that seemed willing to really, really work with them. And a lot of organizations are out there raising money and saying that they'll help, and they help under the assumption that everything's not going completely to crap in your life. And the Mitzvah Foundation, simple things. They were responsive. They brought the stuff to her right away. Yeah. And other places expect you in the middle of some chaotic domestic violence thing to come get stuff.
Right.
And you just, it's not laziness. You don't have the time. So without further ado, Levi Blair, and the second Levi I've ever met in my life. good to meet you. Thanks for coming.
Yeah, you too. Thanks for having me on, Mark. Appreciate it.
How'd you get involved with the Mitzvah Foundation?
Good story there. So I first got involved with the Mitzvah Circle Foundation. Back in the 2015 timeframe, I was in the middle of a MBA program at Villanova, and we did a nonprofit practicum as one of our capstone courses, and our group was introduced to Fran Held, who is the founder and executive director of the Mitzvah Circle Foundation. And we did a little project for her, just kind of helping her on some strategy and some things like that for our class and our project. And I ended up, after graduation in 2015 with the MBA, I stayed in close contact with Fran because, she had a huge impact on me, just learning the way she helps people and her selflessness and all the stuff that goes along with that. So I stayed in close contact with her. And then, lo and behold, a couple years later, it was only a year later, she asked if I would be willing to join the board of directors for Mitzvah Circle. And I said, absolutely. And so I've been involved since 2016. And we've been growing leaps and bounds and helping a lot of folks along the way. So that's how I got involved with Mitzvah.
What's one of the first things you remember after getting on the board or dealing with them that that made you realize how important what they do is?
Well, first and foremost is, I think just by being involved closely, you can see where, this Mitzvah Circles is a place where the rubber really meets the road in terms of charitable organizations. They do the little simple things that might be meaningless or have, little significance in most everyday people's lives. But the things that they help out with people in need, little things like, toiletries, shampoo, socks, shoes, backpacks for kids, those little things that, we kind of take for granted. Means a lot to people in need at their time of need. And seeing some of those stories and hearing some of those testimonials from people that the Mitzvah Circle Foundation has helped along the way is what really stuck with me, front and center from day one, from being involved.
Well, it's interesting that you say that, because what happens is a lot of people take it for granted, like I was saying at the beginning, that people have the same access to stuff. We all have equal access and equal availability. And when any of these foundations get involved in stuff, it's because something's going wrong in somebody's life, and they're right. diminished in one way or another, and they're just resources are there. And it is those little things. And I think what I remember in the case that I was telling you about was it was diapers. Mm-hmm. Was the big thing. Yeah. And people don't realize that in the midst of something, you have something, a couple breaks up, they have a falling out or whatever, and then the mother is typically with the children. A lot of things that we see is that in the course of raising children, they become a little isolated, and mm-hmm. And it's tough to get back out there, and you've got two children on you, and then it's just different things. It's, you know, you're foundation was a godsend. I hear mothers talk about the godsend of being able to have food delivered to your house, right. you know, online, for several reasons. One of which is the convenience and not having to get the kids together and go out and do everything. The other thing is being able to spend half the amount you would than if you took the kids in the supermarket and sure. they're exposed to all the marketing yeah. and they want all the different stuff. And I don't understand the whole. It seems, you know. There needs to be more organizations like that because I don't understand the logistics of how you do things as a parent. I mean, as parents, let alone a single parent, I get lost right at, you know, not to sound silly, but I was thinking, how do you go to the bathroom? How's that work? Because there's always a kid pulling it one way or another. And yeah. You can't just leave them out because you can't leave kids unattended. Yeah. But... how many people do you think you guys help a year?
Well, I brought a couple numbers with me to kind of give you an idea of the sense of growth and how many folks we're helping. So actually this past Saturday, we celebrated our 10-year anniversary.
Okay.
So Mitzvah celebrated its 10-year birthday, I guess you'd say. Fran started it in 2009 just by helping some folks that needed it on a case-by-case basis at that time. And then, you know, in 2010s when they really started getting some steam and, you know, recording some figures. So just to give you a little idea, in 2010, the Mrs. Circle Foundation helped out 430 families in the region, greater Philadelphia region, with the help of 187 or so volunteers over the course of the year that helped come in and put all those boxes together, those care packages together that we bring to folks. And they distributed about 12,000 diapers. Okay. And then fast forward until numbers for last year, we helped 11,821 families, got the help of 4,100 volunteers over the course of the year. So 4,100 volunteers came in, helped put those packages together, drive them to the places where they're needed, and dropped off to the folks that need them. And we distributed last year almost 1.1 million diapers. So that's quite a leap. And it's helped out a lot of folks. So they've grown leaps and bounds at Mitzvah.
And there's no charge for any of this.
No, there's not.
And anybody can ask for the help, and if it's available, they'll get it, right?
Yeah, yep. So you can, you know, at the end of this, I could give it to emails or whatever.
Give it twice. Give it now.
Yeah, so if you know someone that needs some help or would like to, you know, ask for help yourself, there's a couple ways you can do it. You can give the Mitzvah Circle Foundation a call at 215-828-6647, or you can email at info@mitzvahcircle.org. ORG. So it's Mitzvah Circle, MitzvahCircle.org.
And if you want to volunteer too, you can contact them there. Or,
yep, you can do that as well. You can call and email for volunteers. So we have, you know, really. You know, we've grown, the Mitzvah Circle Foundation has grown to a staff of six, full-time folks, and that's organizing and putting together these packages along with, you know, like I said, 4,100 volunteers that are coming through every year. It's a very large effort to get all those volunteers, everybody organized, doing the right thing, getting the right packages put together, you know, picking the right size baby clothes, picking the right size kids' shoes, all that kind of stuff, and then getting the packages directly to the families who need them. So when I say that, you know, this is the place where the rubber meets the road in terms of charitable donations, that's exactly why.
Do you do any of the field stuff? Do you ever go out in the field and give out stuff? Or?
No, I've, you know, done a lot of donation myself. We, you know, as a board, we do a lot of the overall kind of strategy and paths forward and strategic initiatives for things like, you know, fundraising to logistical needs to new warehousing space needs, things of that nature. And obviously, if, you know, myself, I've been in there doing some volunteering and things like that myself over the past couple of years. So there's always a need for folks to come through and take a look at what we're doing and help us out. There's always a need for donations. We're mostly run through personal donations and corporate donations and grants when we can get them. So
what makes you, how old are you about?
I'm 37.
37.
Yeah.
Okay. So you get like cheap rental rates, almost an adult, all that stuff.
Yeah.
What makes you want to do this? What would you say to inspire other people to, for lack of a better term, get off their butts and do something to help? Because it just seems that's one of the things that kind of impressed me was that you spoke so highly of this and you were so, it was like a point of pride with you to speak about the work you do with them.
Yeah.
And, you know, and when you ask people what they do now, they do, well, I play Xbox,
right?
Or I do this, or I do that.
Yeah.
No offense. No offense. I'm sorry. I realized I was too close after I said it. That was very thoughtless of me.
Yes, it was. You should be ashamed of yourself.
Go back to Minecraft. what would you say to somebody who wanted who was on the fence about volunteering somewhere?
Yeah, I'd say, you know, if you're sitting around waiting for the right time to do something, that's not the right answer. It's always the right time to get off your butt and try to do something. I mean, there's lots of organizations that need help, you know, and your time is a valuable resource. I mean, I know a lot of people, you know, always think of helping charities in the form of they got to give them a monetary contribution. Well, that's not necessarily true. You can volunteer your time. You can volunteer your expertise. You can volunteer your ideas. There's all kinds of things you can do to help out folks in need through different organizations. So I'd say that if you're looking for the right time to do something, that the time is now.
Yeah, and I think part of the problem with volunteerism in general, and I think is that we've gotten too fixated on what you said there about people thinking about just giving money. Mm-hmm. And I think that by thinking that money is the solution, we've created different problems.
Right.
And I think that the most valuable thing is the volunteer's time. And you try and make the best use of that. And,
sure.
You know,
yeah.
We run the little nonprofit that I do off of nothing. And it's painful to see waste in other organizations when you're running one of these or like I'm sure that you have with your foundation, there's other foundations out there that you would love to have their money. Mm-hmm. Imagine what
oh,
you
yeah,
would do.
Absolutely.
You know,
yeah.
And there's this whole thing where foundations get to a certain size and they get bloated.
Mm-hmm.
And there's just, you know, I worked at one place for the longest time and I remember that you got to have nice things. But I remember a CEO had a $25,000 bookcase in the office, you know, and you got to put out a good presentation.
Right.
But there's a point where it's tough to beg when you've got that level of opulence, you know.
No kidding.
And you are, you were in the Navy.
Yes, I was. Yep.
And you were rank of lieutenant on a submarine.
Yep. I was a 03 lieutenant when I got out. I went to officer candidate school after I graduated from college back in Indiana in 2005 and went to